Hello and welcome to the first video of 2021. It's been a while. The last video is a few months ago. It's been very hectic and busy. I hope you all had a good break over the holidays. In this video, we're going to look at the various options to replace your Windows machine with Linux if you are running Zoho. If you're not running Zoho, this video will still be very helpful to you. I mean, it's not exclusive to Zoho, but the latter part of the video, we're going to look at the Zoho applications that are supported and how you would install it. Now, in case that you're asking what I'm running here right now, it is a modified desktop. On Pop OS. So we'll go into that a little bit later. But first, let's look at the various options there are and which ones I would recommend if you're new to Linux and are running Zoho in your business. I wrote a blog article a few months ago. Actually, it was 24th of November 2019. At that time, Windows 7 would go out of support in a few months. That's now well over a year ago. So if you're still running Windows 7, you should really change that. I'll put the link to the blog in the description, but you can find that also here on the top. And where it comes to, you know, the Linux distribution of choice, here are the applications that are provided by Zoho itself. Now, I focused on the Debian package managed application, and if you don't know what that is, then don't worry about it. If you do know what that is, then you know that there's Debian, there's Debian based, there's Red Hat based, and there's Arch based. And Zoho comes with the biggest support for Debian, so that's why I focus on the Ubuntu derivatives of Linux. And here in the blog, you actually see a number of distributions with some screenshots that you can choose from, and really Linux is easy to use, and we'll go through that as well. So the first one here, Zorin OS, a little description, some shots, and a link to the website. Same with Linux Mint, Ubuntu itself, Peppermint OS. I just added recently Farin OS. I actually think it's a very, very good and nice operating system, especially if you're coming from either Windows or Macintosh or even a Chromebook. You can easily adapt the UI to what you want to have. So I like Farin OS a lot. I'm not using it though. And here is KDE Neon. I've been running that for a while. So when I'm writing that application, the second screenshot, this is default. The second screenshot here was actually my KDE Neon. Very customizable. Do I recommend it? Yes, I do, if you know what you're doing and like to customize and tinker with things. If you want stability, I probably go for a Zorin OS, or what I'm going to show you here is Pop OS. So again, the links are here. If you click on how to install, there's actually a help desk article that is in my business with how to create a bootable USB, etc. So I'll link that. Well, it's actually linked in the article. So if you go to the article, you can click through. Very easy to do. So let's just pop into a virtual machine where I got now Windows running. So here we go, and let me just make this a little bit bigger for you. All right, good. So if you want to download a Linux distribution, you just simply go to the website where you want to download it from. Now, I am running Windows in the VM, so it's not going to be as quick as you'd like. Actually, Windows is never as quick as I'd like, so it seems to be doing some stuff on the background here. And here we go. Now, this is all default Windows. It's got Edge. You probably would have changed your browser to something else. I, by the way, run on Brave. Again, you can choose whatever you want to run your browser on. Okay, so if you want to download Rufus, I believe the website is rufus.ie. Here we go. So go to rufus.ie. And you just download that package. It's a very simple package to use. And as always with Windows, we have to exercise our patience. Here we go. Now, what does it do? Once you downloaded the application, you don't need to install it. You just double-click to run it from your downloads folder. And you select the device here, which is your USB drive. So you do need a USB thumb drive. And it needs to be empty, or it needs to have information that you don't mind losing. Because what this is going to do, it's going to completely wipe your USB drive, right? So you can still use it later on, but it's for the installation, everything that's on it will be gone. So you basically select the drive you want to burn your image into, and then the image file that you've downloaded, you select it by clicking the select button, and you just follow the instructions and click start. Do not remove the USB drive before the writing is done. That will definitely, you know, destroy it. You have to go through some various lengths to actually recover that one. So make sure that the process here is completely done and finished and green and not writing before you remove the drive or switch off your computer. You can download Rufus here. It's a, just take the top one, 3.13 at this moment. It could be a different version when you download it. I think they're still working on it and releasing new patches and updates. All right, now let's go to where you can download your operating system. What I'm showing you today is the installation for Pop OS. It's actually not in the list of applications that I recommend for Windows 7 users, but it's a similar installation process. So Pop OS is part of System 76. So you go to System76.com. All right, now System 76 is a hardware company. So if you want to buy a computer that has Linux pre-installed, can definitely recommend them. They're very, you know, high-end hardware. It's all open source hardware, so you can download the schematics and everything. They manage the firmware for you as well, give you patches. It's quite good, but you know, they're premium devices. They are not for your for your throwaway PCs. But you can download Pop OS separately as well. So just go to Pop OS. And then you can click download. Now, when you download Pop OS, you can choose between the latest release, which is 2010, or the LTS release. Now, LTS stands for long-term support. They're typically supported for 5 years. The long-term, so the regular releases, they update every 6 months and are supported for 9 months after the next update. So you obviously will need to continue updating your system. The updates is relatively simple. It's not something that you you have to worry about. It's just you run the updates and it just runs it. That's fine. But for the long-term stability, you choose the 2004 LTS long-term support. The long-terms are updated itself every 2 years. So there's now 2004. The next one will be 2204. So 20 stands for the year, and the 04 is the month of release. So in April 2022, there will be a new version, and this one will be supported, I think, to 2025. The new one here, 2010, that one has been released in October. The next one will be 2104, and then 2110, and then you get the 2204 long-term release again. So you can choose whatever you want to use. Now, if you know which that your laptop or computer has NVIDIA video cards, you can download the 2010 with NVIDIA drivers. If you don't know or you don't want to use the NVIDIA drivers, you can just download the 2010 here. Same with the LTS, by the way. I've already downloaded it, so you don't need to go through that. And what I'll show you next is how to install it. So I'm going to shut down this virtual machine, and we're going to create that installation disk as if it is a real new computer. So now let's just assume you got your USB drive, and you know how to get into the boot menu of your computer. If you don't know, usually it's either Escape, F2, F9, or F10, sometimes F11 or 12. It depends on your notebook brand. So if you don't know, just search the notebook brand and model boot menu. So boot menu and then your notebook brand and model, it will show you how, or you find a link on how to get in there. All right, I'm just going to start Pop! OS here. This is actually linking to the ISO of the of the boot file. So we're just pretending that I'm booting from the ISO here. Now there's a lot of stuff coming by. Sometimes you see a fail, sometimes you see, you know, just ignore everything that comes down here, right? Most things should just be okay. Just ignore everything that's in here. And by the way, if you've installed the software, you won't see this. Again, it will be a nice screen that says, hey, we're loading Pop! OS. And by the way, it's super fast as well. This is starting with a USB key. What it does, it actually extracts all the files as well. So it's a bit slower in the startup. Okay, now we're in the live session here. What I'm going to do is I'm just going to tell the system to use a different screen resolution, so you have more real estate to look at. Okay, it's going straight into the installer. Just 1 second. Here we go. And this screen is a 1920 by 1080. Apply. Yep, keep the changes. All right, so it goes straight into the installer. The first thing that we'll notice is, okay, you need to check your language. So we keep it on English. Then you say, okay, which is the region of your English? Now, we are in Australia. You pick in the English that you want or your own language. Then it goes for the keyboard layout. You can test the keyboard layout. So you just click here and you can test it. So if you type an A and a Z comes out, then you probably have the wrong keyboard layout, French or something like that. All right, so let's do select. Now, the next thing you can do is clean install. So if you're installing cleanly on your drive, you say, hey, this notebook or computer I'm no longer using, I'm going to clean install it. That means it wipes every data and reinstalls it with Pop! OS. If you're more advanced, you can actually partition your hard drives yourself. I would not recommend that. So we're going to do a clean install, fresh copy. All right, now this is a virtual machine, doesn't have a lot of drive in here. There's a virtual block, it's 25 gig. You don't need a lot more than that, by the way, to run it. Typically, you know, computers have between 128 gigabytes SSD to, you know, 512, even terabytes. So you shouldn't have any problems with your drives. So we're going to do erase and install. Now, by default, Pop! OS is asking you to put an encryption keyword, which is a password to decrypt your hard drive. So if you're having a laptop and you bring it with you all the time and your laptop gets stolen or you lose it somewhere, it's very easy to get in your hard drive and take all the contents if you have a bootable USB drive. You don't need to log in then, right? But you can just take the contents out. If you're encrypting your drive, there's just no way that people can get that content without decrypting the drive first, and that's what you use your password for. Now, the challenge is you can only do this at the time you install your software. You cannot do this later on, and you can also not remove it later on without reinstalling the software. So you do need to take care, like, do you want the encryption? And the second thing is, if you lose that password, there's no recovery. So if you lose that password, there's no recovery. If you are going to set up a password, make sure it's a strong one. And also make sure it's not the same as your user password that we're going to use to log in. So those that's important. It needs to be a different password than your user password when you log in. Technically, the system will accept that they are the same, but it just creates extra weakness in there. So if you take the effort to encrypt your drive, make it a different password than the one you use to log in. I'm not going to encrypt it here. This is a virtual machine. I just don't care. So I say, don't encrypt. Now it's partitioning the drive and it's going to install. Now the installer is actually very, very quick. You do not need to do anything else. Now I am going to pause this video and resume when it is done. Okay, the installation has been complete. Now, in Pop! OS, it actually does something called an OEM install. That means I don't get to enter user credentials at the installation itself. So the only password that we would enter is if you choose to encrypt your drive. So if you're setting this system up for someone else, you don't need to do anything else. You just basically shut down, and as soon as the other person, the recipient of the computer, boots up the computer, that's where they set up their username and everything else. Other installations, like for instance Zorin OS or Farin OS, they don't have any of these issues, these options, right? So Zorin OS, you cannot do an OEM install, at least I haven't found one. So that means you need to set up the user account the moment you install the system. So that's okay if it's your own laptop, not so much if it's for someone else. Okay, now I'm going to do a restart of the device, and I can just shut it down right now, and I'm going to start it up again and show you what the base desktop of PopOS looks like, and also how you can modify it to make it, you know, what you'd like it to be. After that video, when it's done, and we've also installed some Zoho apps, after that we're going to go into the Arch Linux, which is an instant OS, and just to show you what a different Linux flavor looks like and what the main differences are. So I'm just going to open up PopOS again. And now it's booting up for the first time. Alright, so we get the welcome screen, and by the way, because we booted up PopOS from a fresh install, it didn't take up my screen resolution. So everything you've done in the live CD, so before you actually do the installation, that's now gone. So the next time I'm going to set up my display, it will remember what it is. So now I'm actually booting from the hard drive. So I just click next in the welcome screen. You show here the English Australian. Now it picked that up from the installation, so that's fine. We'll just leave it as it is. And you can enable or disable your location services. So if you are privacy sensitive, you don't want to share your location, you just switch this one off. If you do want to use location, and particularly with Nightlight, it uses location for your sunset and sunrise times. You know, there's some extra functionality. I'm going to leave it on here, but it is a choice that you have. Okay, now it selects here where you are. I'm somewhere over here. Here we go, Sydney, Australia. Next. Now, if you want to link your online accounts, you can do that. Not all of them are equally functional, I have found. Like, for instance, with Microsoft, it may do your emails. I don't use it, but it doesn't link your OneDrive. With Google, if you got a Google Drive, it will actually link your Google Drive as a mounted option in your system. I don't have Facebook, I don't have Flickr, I don't have Foursquare, so but you know, you can log in whatever you think is appropriate for you. I'm gonna skip all these things here right now. Now we're gonna get your login name. So you're gonna say your name, and it generates a username for you. This username cannot be changed, right? So that's how you're gonna log in. Now, I don't like to type all that, so I'm just gonna do Matt, right? So you can make up your own username as well, but it automatically prefills it. Some other distros, they just keep the first name, and others yet, they just make the first name plus the first letter of your last name. Now, do note that everything here is lowercase. Unix or Linux is case sensitive, so I would definitely advise to keep it lowercase just as it is. All right, so we just do next, and now you have to set up a password. And again, make your password not the same as the one that you use to encrypt your drive, and also not 1234. So my passwords are reasonably good. So you can see here that the green bars here, that shows the how strong your password is. If you got just one bar here and it's red, you should definitely consider changing your password. So it gives you some guidance. If the passwords are not the same between here and confirm, you can't click next. So if you're wondering, like, hey, how come I can't go further? That is because the passwords aren't the same. All right, next. Now what this does, it creates my home directory and everything. So now I can start using PopOS. Okay, here we go. So first I'm gonna make this screen a little bit bigger, and this time it will remember it over the boots. Okay, if you do not like this background, you can add your own backgrounds in here. Just right click and go to change background. And what you see here, this is the default pop background, and you can choose from whatever is in here, or you can add your own picture via add picture. I'll just go for this one over here. This one is nice. I'm gonna do this one here. So now your background has been changed. It's actually very easy to do. Now what you notice in Pop! OS, there is no start menu and there is no dock. Your screen is completely blank and empty, and that is for you to have as much screen real estate without distractions as you. So if you want to go to start an application, so your desk was all blank, in order to do that you click the super key. Super key is your Windows key in Windows. Now, because we're not using Windows or Mac, so we don't use the term Windows key or Command key. We use the Super key or Meta key. So if you see Super or Meta, it is that Windows key or Command key that is on your Windows or Mac keyboard, respectively. If you press that, what you will see is a set of applications here in the Favorites bar. So you can start these, and you see these 9 dots here. That shows you all applications that are in here. So there's not much. It comes with an office, LibreOffice. So it's got all the basics done, but you will be installing more software. The first thing we're going to do though is we're going to update the system. So you already got a message sort of popping by that there's an update ready. So what we're going to do is we're going to start PopShop. So if we go to PopShop and then click Install, it immediately checks for the updates. Now, the difference between a Windows machine and a Linux machine is that Linux updates everything. So it doesn't just update the operating system, it updates all the applications you got from the store. And it does it at once. And you can also choose when to update. So it will never force you to update. So if you're ready to get ready for an online meeting and you start up your PC and then it goes into an update cycle and it takes you like 20, 25 minutes, that's not happening here, right? It's a very quick process. Typically, it takes less than a few minutes. Now, this is obviously a very large update because we just downloaded the install. And since the install from 2010, which is October 2020, so there's obviously quite a few updates that need to be done. So we're just going to do update all. Now, one thing you notice with Linux is it's got a very good security. So no application can change the base of the operating system, like installing applications, removing applications, changing system settings without typing in your password. So it's a little bit more work than just pressing yes continue in Windows. I don't actually know what it is in Mac. I believe you need to enter a password as well. But it's very easy to do, and it also stops you from basically installing things that you're actually not aware of. So it's an extra security, and I would definitely say you can't really remove that anyway unless you just take the password out. There are ways to remove it, by the way. I'm just would not recommend it. So as you can see, it's now updating the settings app. Here the 99 updates are probably going to be a little bit bigger. It will update Firefox as well, and so it will update all the extensions that are there. Now if you look here, these are the applications that are installed and these are up to date. So we just let this process run. As you can see, it goes actually quite quick. The files typically are a lot smaller than in Windows. While that's running, let's just go through and see what we have for an operating system. So if you go to this activities, or you press the super key, what you'll find is there's type to search. Here you can type in your application you want to see. If the application is not installed, it will actually gives you a PopShop link to install the application as well. So I'm just going to open settings and show you what I'm actually running in this VMware. Now obviously you can select your network. If you got a wireless network, you can choose your wireless network over here and log in. If you have Bluetooth, fine. Appearance, you can choose your themes, your background, and your appearance, dark or light theme. How your notifications would come in, so you can have do not disturb, lock screen notifications, etc. Your search, where you want to search in, etc. So it's just go through this one by one. But what we're going to do here is I'd like to go into my about section. So this is what we're running, right? We're running Pop OS with 4 GB of memory, slightly less, obviously on a virtual machine. So if you want to see what you're running and how much how much memory you have, etc., what your device name is, you can run that here in about. If you want to see some more details, just press super key T, which is your terminal. Now, for a lot of people, they go like, oh, I don't want to use the terminal. So let's just see what we have in NeoFetch. And by the way, this is not yet installed by default, I believe, so it's not found. But what it says here, if you want to install it, you just type in this command. So I showed you earlier the pop shop where I'm doing all the upgrades. While it's upgrading, I can't install anything. It's locked at the moment, right? But if you enter these commands here, you can also install applications. You don't have to use the graphical user interface to install everything. Let's just go back to home here in the pop shop, and I'll show you that install later. So what you find here in the pop shop is you can install any application. So you got some pop picks, which is kind of like the favorites, and whatever other application or other distro you use, they'll have their own shops, right? You got the GNOME store, you got the Ubuntu store. If you use KDE, you got Discovery from KDE Neon. So there's quite a bit in here. And you'll see a lot of applications that you are already familiar with. Now, one thing I can tell you already, Microsoft Office will not run. So LibreOffice, OnlyOffice, those are your alternatives. LibreOffice comes pre-installed. It's pretty good. I do think the UI looks a bit dated, but it does what it needs to do. For Zoho users, we will use obviously Zoho Writer and Zoho Sheets. And there is a Linux client for Zoho Writer to have it actually installed on your computer instead of going to the website all the time. So you can browse through the various categories. So what's there on audio, for instance, you just click on audio and it will open that up. And it will show you what the contents are. Here you go. But you can also very easily go to home and search whatever you want. So what do I use for recording videos? I use Open Broadcast Studio. So you find OBS, you just type in OBS. And what you do is you simply install it. You do not need to buy software in Linux. Obviously, some software is not free. But most software here in the shop is just, if not all the software in the shop is free. Free as in no charge. But also free as in you're free to use it as you wish and free to modify it as you wish under the GPL license. So it's a little bit different than a lot of the software and the Windows machines. So OBS, Open Broadcast Studio. If you want to edit your videos, you can do OpenShot, I think it is. Here you go, it's a video editor. You can install something for your pictures, so if you want to manipulate photos, GIMP is a kind of like a Photoshop alternative. It's not as easy to use if you're not into photo editing. So it's got a lot of options, very very functional rich. For drawing, you can try out Krita. Here you go. So that's a drawing. Now, if you want to see some more information on these things, you just click on them, and then you see some information and potentially a screenshot. Now, things on the virtual machine are relatively slow, right? So here you go, a screenshot of Krita. You see what it is. By the way, this is a Flatpak. So you have Flatpak and Debian files. Those are both supported in Pop OS, and you can choose which one you want to have. Don't install both. It's actually still the same application. Except the delivery method is different. So Flatpak is kind of distribution independent, so you can have it on Ubuntu based, you can have it on Red Hat based or on Arch based. Whereas Debian files, they're, as it says, Debian. It comes from the operating system Debian, distro Debian, and Ubuntu itself is based on Debian. So now, since PopOS is based on Ubuntu, it uses the Debian file. So you can't install Red Hat Package Manager, which is RPM files. That will never work on a Debian-based system. So this is a little bit about the packaging. There's no snaps here, so if you're familiar with snaps, they're not on here, and yeah, you won't miss them. Okay, so here we go. Now let's see how far we are in the installation. So I'm just gonna go away from here, and let's see how far this is. So I'm still updating all these files here. Now, if you want to know what's in here, you can just click on this one here as well, and it actually tells you what it actually is going to install. Right, so it's quite a bit actually. It's a big install. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to pause the video, and we're going to pick it up when the installation is finished. Okay, the update has been done. It will most likely need a reboot after such a big update. It will tell me if I do. So far it hasn't told me anything yet, so it should be okay. But we're not going to reboot anyway. We're just going to install some other applications. So I showed you before how to do another install, which is NeoFetch. Now NeoFetch is nothing more than a little application that shows you in the terminal what you're running, how much memory you're consuming. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to install NeoFetch. Now it gives me the command already because NeoFetch wasn't found, but it can be installed with. And then you just enter this command here. So I'm just going to enter it here. Again, I need to enter my password. Now, why is that? I say sudo. Sudo is actually sudo. It's super user do. So I need to enter my super user password, which is the same password as my normal login password because I'm automatically added to the sudo users. Here we go. NeoFetch is going to be installed. Again, you don't have to browse the web for these type of applications. If it's in the repository, it will just download it. Now it will ask you, do you really want to install this? Yes, I want to install it. By the way, just enter will give you the yes as well, because the Y was a capital and the N is a small letter. So very simple, actually. So it's installing it here right now, and now I can run NeoFetch and show you what it's actually running. So here we go. NeoFetch. Ah, there you go. System restart required. Okay. So here is NeoFetch. So it tells me I'm running PopOS 2010. Now we know that already. But what's more importantly, it tells me how much memory I'm consuming right now. So with all the apps that I've been running from the start, I actually use about 1.4 gigabytes of memory. Now, Pop uses GNOME. GNOME is a desktop environment I very much like. It's very stable. But it does use a lot more memory. So for instance, a KDE environment with the same operating system would use about 750 megabytes. If I go to Instant OS, that's using, I believe it's Awesome in the main, I don't know what they actually use. I think it's Awesome. They use like 300 meg, right? It's just like nothing. You can run it on a very, very old PC. Now, this is running on a 4 gigabyte virtual machine. It's not as snappy as my actual desktop, but hey, it will work. And if you have an older PC, this will work just fine. So anyway, that's NeoFetch. I'm just gonna exit this one here. What else should you install? Now, I told you that we're going to go through some Zoho stuff, but first I'm going to install the Brave browser. So what you saw me using in my operating system, I was using Brave. So you can go into Firefox first. We do need to go into the browser, and then we can install Brave browser. First time I log into Firefox, so you get all the notices and the privacy things and whatever. So I'm going to brave.com. And by the way, you don't have to install Brave. You can install anything else that you want. If you like Google Chrome, you can install Chrome directly from Google, from the Chrome website. I don't know what that website is. I think it's chrome.google.com. Not sure. If you like Chrome as a browser engine, Brave actually uses Chromium as a browser engine. So it's the same as Chrome, but it's a different browser. Same as Edge, by the way, the latest Edge from Microsoft. You can also download from the Pop Shop Chromium, as a browser. Here you go, Chromium web browser. So Chromium is basically the base system for Chrome, for Edge, for Brave, for many, many other browsers. Not Firefox, by the way. Firefox uses its own browser technology, so that's different. But hey, I'm going to download Brave. So I'm just going to go back here, and it says here, download Brave. This works a little bit different than just downloading it, because what we're going to do is we're going to add the repository for Brave into my Linux environment. So it shows you here, if you use Debian 9 Plus, Ubuntu 14.04 Plus, or Mint 17 Plus. Now we're using Pop, but whether you're using Pop, Ubuntu, Kubuntu, KDE Neon, Farin OS, Zorin OS, this is all the same because it's based on Ubuntu. So you can basically run these commands here in the terminal. Now let me show you how you can do that. So let me just open the terminal. Here we go. And you know how to copy and paste, so you can basically select the commands you want to use and you say copy. Now in the terminal, in order to paste, it is not Control V, it is Control Shift V. So that's in the terminal, and it's the only area in Linux where you don't use, as far as I know, Control V. It's Control Shift V. Now again, you notice the sudo, or sudo, however you want to say it, I need to enter my sudo password. You also notice when I'm typing the password, it actually doesn't move the cursor with the little stars. So that means if someone is looking over your shoulder or from a distance, they won't see any feedback how many characters your password is actually using. So it's an extra piece of security, but it will enter your password. So you don't see the cursor moving, you don't see little asterisks like, hey, I'm entering a password. It will just be blank. Now again, it will ask you, do you want to continue, yes or no? The yes is in capital, that means that's the default. I can just press enter. And then it will do that. So look at what's capitalized. That will be the default. You can obviously always just type the Y. All right, that's done. The next thing, I'm going to copy and paste this command. Now what this does, I have no idea. Don't care. We're just going to put that in. So if you want to know what it does, you can do some Linux administration courses. I frankly don't really care. I do most of it just by copy-paste here. If you do want to learn it, I definitely recommend it. But you know, there's so many commands here that's... All right, now I don't know what this does again, but just copy and paste. And then finally sudo apt update and sudo apt install Brave browser. So the update is actually the same command as that was run by the Pop Shop, where you buy the software, this one here, when you go to installed and having a update. Now, it says here there's another update that we need to do, but probably I'll need to restart first, right? So it's required to complete the installation of the update. So, but first I'm going to install Brave. So first I'm going to update the repository. So sudo apt update. Now you notice it doesn't ask me for my password again, because I'm in the same session. I just entered my password before. So it actually assumes like, hey, you're within a certain time frame in the same terminal session. I'm not going to keep asking you for your password. So it still should not ask me my password now. Here we go. If you don't want to have the prompt, you can do a dash y at the end of the sudo command as well. For me, it doesn't matter. It's just same number of keys that you enter. So, okay, Brave browser has been installed. Now, in order to check this, we can just go and search for Brave. Here we go. Let me just get rid of this notification. See, Brave browser is installed. Now, what I can do is right click on this one and say add to favorites. Okay, now it's added to the favorites. So going back to the favorites, you see now Brave browser here, and I'm going to move that up. I'm also going to remove Firefox from the favorites. So that one is now gone from the favorites. And you can have now start Brave Browser and do whatever you need to do there. Okay. Now, before I do the restart, let's just quickly go over your home files. So here's your file manager. And what you'll notice in Linux, there's nothing called your C drive, your D drive, doesn't exist. Okay, so everything here is just a directory, a folder, which is part of root. All your files are based in the home folder. That's the only area where you can actually just manipulate whatever you need to do, add, delete files, etc. Most other areas, you will need to have your password for a super user. Which is actually your login password again, but it's therefore preventing you from modifying things you shouldn't be modifying. So if you go into, and by the way, this here is the CD from which we installed, right? So that's the Media Pop OS. So it will actually show here as a CD because it thinks it's a CD. If it's a USB, you see a little USB icon. What I'm going to do is I'm just going to eject that one, so now that one is gone. So there's no CD drive as in a D drive or an E drive or an F drive or whatever it's called in your Windows machine. So in the home directory is where everything is. You have your documents, your downloads, your music, your pictures, etc. That's where you place your files. Every user gets their home file. So if you go to the user directories into, or sorry, other locations, and you go to computer, what you see here is, and by the way, little arrows means it's a link, and the X means you can't access that one. Now the root directory is where the super user, the root user, has their files. As a normal user, we can't access that one. I can go sudo into that root directory, but you really should not be doing anything there. All right. So that means you can't even see what's in there. So if I look here at home, this is where you find all your users. Right, so now it's home mat. If I have another user, then there will be that username with the home directory as well. If that username logs in and goes into home, it will just go directly into that home directory. So let's just go back. So if I click here on mat, then you see it's the same, right? So basically it's a shortcut into that area. And that's actually very interesting to note. A lot of people get lost on the drives in Linux. There are no drives in Linux. Well, there are, it's called media. And they're called SD and then a letter, like A, B, C, D, and E, and then a number for the partition. So the letter is the physical drive and the partition is then a number. So you got, for instance, SDA1 is the first partition on your first drive that it recognized. SDB is your second drive. And if you partition it, you have SDB1, SBD2, etc. You don't need to know any of that because those drives will just be under media. So if you go into other locations, they will run into media, and this is where your mount points will be. So media and then the user, and then here there's nothing here because I ejected that drive. Otherwise you would have seen that CD drive there. What it does for you in Pop! OS, actually in your file manager, files, it will just create that entry here so you don't have to remember where it is. It will say, hey, here's a USB drive, here is a CD drive. So don't worry about drive locations, just remember these locations here. This is where you do your stuff. All right. Zoho. As you know, Zoho delivers a lot of applications that you can download and you can use. So the first thing that we're going to do is download Zoho Mail. Now, the Mail app, you obviously can access Zoho Mail via your browser. That's fantastic. There's also a separate app. But before we download the Mail app, we actually need to download a little application to integrate app images. Unfortunately, it is not in the Pop! Shop. So if I go to the Pop! Shop, here we go. If I go into the Pop! Shop and do app image, I want app image launcher, right? It's not here. It's just, there's no app image launcher in the Pop! Shop. So I need to download it from somewhere else. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to basically download that from another website. Okay, I will add this directory into the description. But you go basically to github.com/theassassin/appimagelauncher/releases/tag/v2.2.0. Okay. What do you now need to do is download a small application and install that. Now, for those of you that have paid attention, I mentioned there are various application types, package types that you can use. There is an RPM for the Red Hat Package Manager. We're going to use the DEB, which is Debian file, right? And by the way, you can also download the source and build it yourself. I prefer to use this pre-built. It's easier, you know, nothing really can go wrong. But you do need to download the right one. Now, chances are you're running a 64-bit x64. It is named AMD 64. That doesn't mean it doesn't work on Intel. Okay, so AMD 64, because AMD just happened to be with the 64 architecture before Intel. That's what it's been called in Linux since then. ARM 64 is obviously on the ARM architecture. And the i386 is a 32-bit. What we need to do is download the Bionic ARM AMD 64. So it's either Bionic or I think the other one's Groovy Gorilla. I don't know what the Ubuntu ones are called, but just go for the Bionic one here. And if you see another one, AMD 64, you can use that. But for now, okay. All right. Now you want to open this application with a program called Eddy. Eddy is a software installer, package installer for custom packages that you download that are not in the shop. So we are opening this one with Eddy. Okay, here we go. Very quick. Now, Eddy is a very simple program. It gives you one choice. You can exit or you can install. So we're going to install. Again, surprise. We need to enter our password because we're going to add an application. So it's running the installation. And what you notice, if you're a Windows user, it doesn't ask you where to place things, you know, which directory, which folder. It's just a very simple, everything will be in the default folders, and Linux will take care of that for you. So in order to download the Zoho Mail Desktop Client, go to zoho.com/mail/desktop. Here we go. And then we say download for Linux. It recognizes you on a Linux machine. And then you have to choose between 64-bit or 32-bit. Now we're going to choose the 64-bit because we're in a 64-bit operating system. It asks you where to download it. By default, it goes into your downloads folder. And let's just save it over there. Okay, so it's now downloading in the downloads folder. Okay, it's now downloaded and I can open the application. And here is what the App Image Launcher does. It actually says, do I want to run this application or do I want to, you know, and move it into a different folder to create a shortcut and all those things. So we're just going to say, yep, everything is fine. We're going to run this and integrate it. So integrate and run. And what you'll notice, the first time you launch this application, you have to do it a number of times. So first it says, okay, you need to, yes, okay, understand the risks. And what it will give you, it gives you an error. It says, cannot mount app image, which is really annoying. But it only happens the first time, the first few times you start it. Once it has completely started, it will never give you that error again. It just runs like an app. So I'm just going to start it again. See, it created an icon for me. I'm just going to add it to my favorites as well. So add to favorites, done. And I can run it. Now it gives me the error again. All right, so there you go. Cannot mount app image. So I'm going to do it again. Now it's here. You notice it's in my favorites. I'm just going to move it a little bit up. and it gives you the error again. Right, just keep doing it, I think, 3 or 4 times, and then it will just finally pick up. I don't know what it does in the background, I have to admit. I just have no idea why this is happening. It's annoying, but only once when you install it. After that, once it starts, hey, it starts. You're fine. Now it's starting. All right, so you have to log into your Zoho Mail app. I'm going to pause it over here. And once I'm logged in, I'll start the Mail app again. Okay, I've ran it a couple of times. It's now logged in and ready to go. I've logged it in my demo environment, by the way, so it's not my real email address. Oh, here we go. Do need to make sure I'm in the right machine. And here we go. So I can start Zoho Mail Desktop, and now it will just start Zoho Mail. Here we go. Now, just on a little bit on the window management here in Pop, what you'll see is only one button. It's called close. So you can close things and that's it. If you want to maximize it, you can double click on it, right? And double click. You can also move it to the top, right? And that maximizes. So that's kind of the same as in Windows. If you like it tiled and you do a manual tile, you can do it this way. Right, but there's some other trick here that I'd like to show you. You see here these windows here. If you click that open, you can have it automatically tile. So if I click that, what it does, it actually tiles the windows automatically for you. So if I just add another window, let's add another terminal. Right, it automatically creates a new tile for the terminal, so you can group your windows the way you want. I can move this one over here. And so change the tiling around. I can close the Pop! OS shop thing. Here you go. So this will automatically tile, and there's a 2-pixel gap between them. So if you don't like that gap, you can just change that gap over here. What you also can do is you can just actually move this one here a little bit larger. I want more real estate, and it actually moves the other windows accordingly. So I don't need that much space for my terminal. Here you go. So I like this styling. It's super productive. If you don't like it, you just go here and switch it off. Do note that once you switch it off, it keeps the current window positions. It will not just mock everything up again. And the other thing is you can add some exceptions for windows that are floating windows exceptions. So for instance, if you never want to have settings tiled, you can just add settings in here. And that will just never tile the settings. It will just open as a floating window, as they call it. All right, so that's on the tiling thing. Now, we've done the mail installation. Let's just look at some other things you can install. And those are much easier to install. The mail is probably the biggest challenge because it's an app image. There are other app images, by the way, from Zoho. So, but then now you've installed App Image Launcher, you won't have that same issue. So let's go to click, so zoho.com/click, which is the instant messaging client. There you go. Now if we just browse down on this website, let's see, here we go. You can download it from the App Store. Google Play is for your mobile phone, for Windows, Mac, and Linux. So if I click on Linux, what you find here is you have the Fedora 64-bit. That is the RPM package, so we're not using that. And then you have the Ubuntu, which is the Debian package. So if you download that one, what it does, it just says, hey, I'm going to download this, click, and then the version number for AMD64.deb. Yeah, we're going to save that one. That's fine. And once it's done, you guess it, you just open it up with Eddy. Open. Here you go, and install. You noted that you didn't have to enter your password when you're installing an app image. That's because the app image doesn't modify any of your system files. It doesn't add it into your programs group. It creates it in a little file in a folder called applications in your home directory. So if we just go to files, here we go. And note that Eddie is not tiling because it's a too small window. It creates a folder here called applications that wasn't there before, and it places them here and creates a menu item to them as well. So that's why you didn't have to enter your password, because it's actually a self-contained image. It doesn't need any dependencies all built in here. Right, let me just close this one here. So we've done now Zoho Click. So if you go to start and then click, here you go, Zoho Click, and you can just, you know, enter that login and start click. Okay. Now, what else is there? You can obviously look for all the other applications that I mentioned in my blog. So you got Click, you got Zoho Meeting as an app image, you got Sales IQ as a Debian file. So there are many applications you can download from Zoho. Notebook is there. Just download what you need. You don't need everything on your desktop, because everything is still one.zoho.com, and you can do everything you want, or go to your application.zoho.com, so if you're in crm.zoho.com or whatever you subscribe to. So I'm going to stop installing the Zoho apps for now. What I'd like to show you next is how to customize your settings for GNOME. Because you see here, these settings here that I have are completely different than the settings that I have in my other machine, right? So this is my GNOME. So you see transparent top bar, and I don't have this dock here on the side. I got a dock here, which is actually always visible unless I have something maximized. So how do you do that? Where do you get those extensions? And you can go as crazy as you want, but what I do want to warn you is the more extensions you add, the less stable things get, right? So sometimes the extensions break, etc. So, but the operating system will always keep working, so don't worry about that. Now, in order to do extensions, you go to extensions.gnome.org. Here we go. Now, the first thing it will notice is like, hey, you haven't installed the browser extension. You must install the browser extension for this to work. Okay, so here we go. And add to Brave. If you're using Chromium, add to Chromium. If you use the Firefox, then obviously use the Firefox extension. It will detect your browser. It will just do all the right things for you. All right, it's now installed. I've added it to Brave. Good. I don't need to see that anymore, and I can clear this one out. So all I have to do here is just refresh, and you see this here disappear. Now, if it says you need to install Chrome extensions, or desktop extensions GNOME or something like that, you see the command over here on how to install that. It is by default installed in pop, so I don't need to do anything else. I can see here on the installed extensions, the things that I already have. So here you go. And I can see here desktop icons needs to be upgraded. I actually switch it off. I don't like any icons on my desktop, but that's personal. So these are the installed extensions. Let's just add a few. Right. So the first extension that I would always add is floating dock. Go, and I use this one here, so it's no, that's not the one I use. Floating dock here, this is the one I use, I think. Yeah, that's the one. So this dock here, it looks a bit different, nicely rounded instead of this squarish dock here. It's floating, not stuck to the window. And I can move it down. You can move this dock down as well, by the way. But here you got some more customization effort, and I can make it appear all the time, which I think is actually quite a big advantage. So I'm going to install this one. So that's been installed now, it's running. Now the dock is over here, so if I just close this window, the dock is over here, and you see now it always is visible because there's no window overlapping it. That for me saves me a click. I don't have to click activities, I don't have to hit the meta key. So what I can do now is I'm going to search for an app called extensions. And this is where you manage the settings of your extensions. Alright, so floating dock, this is my manually installed. So the built-in extensions are over here, and my manually installed extensions are here. And I just click on the settings. And I can show it on all monitors or on a specific monitor. Now this is a VM with only one monitor, so it doesn't really matter. And I want it on the bottom. So there you go, it's on the bottom now. You can change the size and all that stuff. What I'd like to do is to make it transparent. So I set the transparency opacity to 0%. There we go. And if I close this one now, as you can see, it is transparent. So it starts looking like the other application already that I had. So let me open up Brave again. By the way, Brave, you do need to tell it to use the GTK browser. It's not set as default, so I want to set it as default as well. Let's go to Brave, and I'll just put it here on sync. I haven't found the actual menu for setup yet. I always go through sync. I go to appearance, and I want to use the GTK theme. See, now it nicely looks the way that the rest of PopOS uses. So I'm telling Brave to use the GTK Plus theme, and it will just follow the PopOS theme. So that's actually pretty good. Okay, I'll close this window again. And we're back at extensions.gnome.org. Let's go back, and I want to install the transparent panel. So I just search for transparent. And I use transparent shell. So if I press, you see here the top bar is obviously not transparent at the moment. If I press the meta key, it will show also this bar here. It is transparent, but not fully. You still see that same as we had in that before we moved the dock down, that it's like, you know, some opacity. It looks like smoke glass. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to make it fully transparent and install. Okay, it's done. There's actually not much else to do. So you see here my top bar, fully transparent now. And I can see this here, that smoke glass area has disappeared. Just makes it look nicer. I like it better. It doesn't do anything useful for you, but you can just install that and just play around with extensions. Not all of them installed. You will see an error. If you see an error, then basically what you do is you, after it's installed, so instead of on or off, you will see error. What you do is you refresh your browser, and then next to error there's coming a red square with an X in it. You click the X and then it removes the extension, so it will just be gone. Okay, fantastic. Last thing I'm going to show you is how to install Zoho WorkDrive Sync. So we go to zoho.com/WorkDrive. And you go to add-ons. Now, desktop sync and TrueSync are very similar. TrueSync doesn't really synchronize to your desktop, only when you download it. Now, that's only available currently for macOS and Windows. Desktop sync definitely is available for any of the operating system flavors. So we're just going to download that one. So all I have to do is download and say that I agree, and it downloads. Now this is not a Debian package. It is not an app image. So we need to do something else. So we're just going to install that one here. So I've downloaded the tar.gz, which is called a tarball. That's nothing but like a zipped. It's a compressed folder. It's an archive folder. So I'm just going to open up my folder. So note here, if I go down and keep pointing down, it should bring up the dock. Yeah. Of course, when you want to show something, it doesn't. Here we go. Okay, so I'm going to open the files and then go into the downloads. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to extract that archive. I'm going to extract it here. So it creates a new folder. I'm going to enter that folder and enter that folder. Now in Pop! OS, I can, and most GNOME desktops, you can just right click in the folder and say open in terminal. So if I do that, now it's opened in the terminal and it has the right folder here. Now, what you need to understand is hidden folders in Zoho and hidden files is not an attribute, it's a name. So a hidden file starts with a dot. So if I want to execute a command, now if I do ls, by the way, it gives you the directory listing, right? So I see only readme and Zoho drive installer desktop, etc., and uninstaller desktop. I can try to run them. I've never been successful running these like this. So if I go to Zoho work drive and then underscore installer, dot desktop. Okay, so if you put a dot and forward slash, it tells you to run it from the current directory that you're in. That's important. Because there's no path made here. So I made that mistake. So just executing the file like this will not give you the right result. So do a dot slash and then work drive installer desktop. Now let's see what happens. It doesn't work. And I've never been able to get it to work like this. But this is what you can do. Do dot slash dot setup. And this will install it for you. This works. Now the dot is the hidden, this is what I wanted to say. If you want to see a hidden file, right? It's actually the, or hide a file, it's you don't change the attribute and say it's hidden like in Windows. What you do is you just precede it with a dot in the file name and then it is a hidden file. I'll show you later on where everything is at. So okay, work drive is now done and you sign in and then you synchronize. It will synchronize it into a folder called work drive. You can amend where your favorites are here, or you can just move those favorites in here and make it easy for you. I'm not going to do that here. I think I'll put an article on that later on. But anyway, we got the work drive now installed. You can log in and it starts synchronizing your folders to your Linux desktop. It's obviously very handy. Okay, just gonna get out of this one and get out of this one here. And get out of this one. So back to the folder structure. So remember I did the dot setup command. So if here I'm in the work drive directory. This is where I was, right? There's no dot setup. So if I do show hidden files, which is control H, you see here the dot setup. So that's the script I was running. Control H again, the hidden files are gone. If you don't want to remember the control H, you can go to this hamburger menu here and then select hidden files. See, and there it is again. So same thing. Okay, so that's hidden files. So we installed Zoho WorkDrive, we installed Zoho Mail, we've installed Zoho Click. You can install Zoho, other Zoho applications are there like Notepad, Meetings, etc. Mostly these are the applications you would use, right? So Click, Mail, and WorkDrive. The rest you don't really need that much. The rest is done from the browser. So I hope this this video was useful to you so far. Now, if you want to stick around, I'm going to shut down this machine and open up an Arch-based machine with a completely different desktop setup. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to say here, shut down. And if you're saying, hey, I know enough, I don't need to know anything else, it's fine. Fantastic. Thanks for watching. Hope this was useful. So I'm just going to power this one off. If you do want to stick around, we're going to start up an Arch Linux. It's Instant OS, and it looks completely different to whatever you've been using so far. So. go. We're going to start this one up. And it goes into a boot menu. This is already installed, so we're not going through the installation process here. I actually like this distribution quite a lot. I'm not using it as my daily driver, but it is snappy fast and it's very easy to use. It looks all right. It doesn't have the eye candy that other OS have, but I must say it actually looks quite pleasant, and it's, as I said, it's super fast to work with. So this is Instant OS. Now it says here you're on a virtual machine. Do you want to switch resolution? Yes, I do. Quite clever, see what it does here. Now I need to do my sudo password to start it. I don't actually know it. Oh, it's finished initializing something. On my production machine, I don't have to do any of that. Okay, finishing installation background. Okay, done. This is Instant OS. Super easy, right? But you see here is a number of desktops, so I can switch desktops. So if I open an application here, right, and you just you press space to launch an application. Yeah, let's press space to launch an application. Let's do Firefox. Here we go. So here's Firefox. It maximizes immediately. Can I do a terminal? I think terminal is a different command in here. I don't know what the command is. Let's add a terminal. See, it's automatically tiling. That's actually done via this button here. So I can tile it this way, this way, this way. Maximize it, floating. So, yeah, I clicked a little bit too far. Here we go. Let's do it this way. If you want to run an update in here, it's simply a command called instant update. So let's see what's here. I do need to do my password again, obviously. Here we go, synchronizing the database, and now it's installing the updates for me. Why I like Instant OS, it's actually super light, super lightweight. I mean, there's almost nothing running here that that hogs up your memory. By the way, you don't see any window titles here. So this is a Alt Q, if I'm mistaken, or Control Q. Control Q. Right, so it's a very simple way of running things up. Now, back to the desktops, right? This desktop is completely fully used. If I enter a new application, it will start tagging, start tiling them. I can also go to desktop number 2, and I got a complete free desktop to use. So let me just use the terminal and do NeoFetch. 256 megabytes it uses. Right, that's absolutely nothing. So compared to the 1.4 gigabytes that I use for GNOME, here you use 256 megabytes. That's it. So if you have a very old machine that you want to use and it runs pretty fast, you can actually run this one here. It's pretty snappy and very low memory footprint. All right, just as the overview of Instant OS, you can install app images here. As you can see, Zoho Mail is already installed here. The app image launcher is also here. You can install things as you want. Now, how to run this part here? If you just press space, you can search for applications, right? So you can do Firefox or whatever it is. If you press escape, then it launches out of that menu. And if you just press enter, it opens up a terminal. If here it decide, you can decide how you want to tile it. If you like tiling, to exit something, just press Control Q in the terminal. By the way, it's Meta Q. Let me see here. So let's open up Firefox. No, that's Ranger. Okay, here we go. Firefox. Let's see. Meta Q. Meta Q exits it. So that's. Anyway, you've seen here, it's a bit different than other operating systems. I don't use this often. I have this on a very old machine. But it's just some different flavors that you can have. And let me just shut this one down and go back to my normal machine. All right. Back to my normal machine. There's a lot of utilities in here that make things easier. Your recycle bin, obviously, you can open that and empty it. There's nothing in here, so nothing that I need, so empty the recycle bin. Same as normal Windows, I would think. A lot less convoluted. What I said before is you see here the bootable or the what you call it, the removable drives. I got my Gmail drive here. I got Pop OS. The CD is in here because that's the thing I popped in. There's TimeShift. TimeShift is, by the way, very good to install. That is a program that keeps a snapshot of your PC, and you put it on a separate drive. So if your main drive fails, you can actually restore the operating system via TimeShift. And a backup drive you need to have as well, where you store all your backups, and that's your user file. So TimeShift is for the system files. Backup, Deja Dupe is a very good one, is for your system backups. Yeah, that's a kind of a overview of Pop and the Linux versions. I hope this is useful. As I said, I recommend an Ubuntu flavor. I would stay away from the Arch flavors if you're not 100% sure what you're doing. Enjoy, and I hope to see you in the next video, and leave a comment if you need help or any advice. Have a great day and see you in the next video.